It's Monday the 18th of February in 2013 and I'm on my way from Sydney out west and currently travelling over the Blue Mountains on my way to Bathurst, where I hope to meet up with a couple of people today. And at 1:30 we'd plan to meet up with an architect.
Hello, I'm Henry Bialowas. I'm an architect here in Bathurst, among other things. So I'm delighted to be able to talk to you both about the background to the bell tower and how I came to be interested in these various things.
Wonderful.
Now, in my own background, as a student, I did a thesis on sacred geometry, uh-huh. among other things.
Among other uh-huh.
Yeah, it was actually called Architecture of the Dark Side. And what I meant by that was the...
Sorry, what university did you attend?
So, this was at RMIT in Melbourne.
Right, yes, Melbourne.
And this wasn't so much the dark in the sense of the occult, but simply the part of architecture that had been somehow occluded. In other words, we don't deal with sacred geometry in the modern sort of age. Mm. But it's occurred to me that there are many people throughout history that have used sacred geometry and sacred places and sacred sites evolved, but we don't have them in Western culture as such. Mm-hmm. So I was intrigued by these things, but this was like 30 or more years ago, and mm-hmm. of course the thesis proved rather disastrous academically. It just wasn't well received because right. it polarized people, and you know, people in those days really weren't interested in, you know, the subtle underpinnings of you know, ancient architecture and all that kind of thing. There's a different movement about now. I think more people are much more open to these things.
Professor Proudfoot probably helped a little bit of that.
Maybe I don't. That's not right. a name that rings a bell immediately. But anyway, more
he wrote
recently,
the Secret Plan of Canberra.
Oh, okay. Well, I've heard of that vaguely, but I'm not familiar with the actual text or the work. Hmm. But more recently, just a few years ago, I was asked to do a talk at the Institute of Architects annual conference, the country division up in Coffs Harbour.
Wow.
And it was on sacred geometry, so you know, it took quite a while for the idea of sacred geometry as being worth talking about, you know, 30 plus years to kind of come around.
Wow.
So to begin with, I was already steeped in symbolism and geometry as part of my background. Mm-hmm. So when I started, I came across this idea of a town square.
Do you mind me asking?
Sure.
How were you steeped in the symbology?
Well, only in the fact that having written the thesis, I did a lot of reading and thinking about these sort of things and pondering, sure. and then eventually realised that it was a dead end academically. So I kind of, I still introduced these ideas into my architecture, into my work, mm-hmm. but I didn't really talk about it. Mm-hmm. I just thought it would embarrass people if I told them that I'm using, you know, the golden ratio and all those sorts of things. Mm-hmm. But now, you know, it's fairly, I mean, there are television programs on pi and the golden mean and all those sort of things. So it's no big deal or no big secret these days. Mm. But in that sense, I had been programmed myself to be aware of these things when I spot them.
Mm-hmm.
And what occurs to me, some years ago I was asked to do conservation and management studies on the old TAFE College buildings and the Carillion, which you would have noticed in the town square.
Mm-hmm.
And part of that made me realise that Bathurst had a town square in 1833, then subsequently somehow lost it. And that to me was peculiar in itself. And I thought, well, how does a town actually lose a town square? And what does the town square mean, and what, where actually is it? So I came across this map, which is Mitchell's signed map of 1833. And there are some things here that I'd like to point out. He writes the word square here, and then he numbers the squares around it, and if you continue that numbering, 9, 10, 11, 12. So what we're doing, what we're dealing with here is a kind of an enigma in a way, because I suddenly thought, well, what is he telling us here?
He's,
I
mean, telling us something. Surveyor. The obvious thing would be going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Exactly right. So surveyors, you know, by definition, are about giving information to people. And yet this guy was doing that, but in a kind of mysterious, enigmatic way.
Mm.
And I thought, well, what is the meaning of these numbers that seem to spiral out from this point? And then when I looked at the square, I suddenly realised this square doesn't have a boundary. All the other squares do.
Mm-hmm.
This square does not have a number. All the others do. This square does not have a name. And in the middle of it, he puts the word church. So the question that I think Mitchell was asking is, what is it that can't be bound, can't be named, can't be numbered, and begins in a geometric spiral?
Begins and ends.
Exactly right. So that's the Omega point. So what he's talking about here is, what he's created here is not just a blueprint for a town, but a blueprint for a way of life. Because what he's done is put the church in the exact Omega point.
In zero.
And so that's the meaning of that spiral, and that to me is the answer to the riddle. What is it that can't be named, bounded, numbered, and begins and ends in infinity? So that to me, I thought, well, what's, you know, who is this guy Mitchell? And then I came across references to him being a Mason, although I've not been able to confirm that in writing.
Right.
Because
he would have been initiated in an English lodge.
Correct. But not only that, he was part of the 59th Regiment.
Ah, which had its own lodge.
Which had a military lodge.
They did sea initiation.
Not only that, but his patron in Australia was George Murray, who was at that time the Grand Master of the London Lodge.
Mm, mm, mm.
Now, it happens that Mitchell was instructed by Governor Darling to create this town plan, but in his instructions he explicitly excluded town squares for the simple reason that Macquarie was very much into town squares because he was a Mason. Mm. But Macquarie was called back to England and faced a tribunal about his profligate spending on things like town planning and all the rest of it. So there was no way that Darling, who was really a military man purely, was going to come out here and then do much the same and follow in the footsteps of Macquarie. So he said to Mitchell, no town plans, no town squares in the town plan. Now, Darling was recalled to England in 1831. This map came out in 1833, just 2 years later.
Oh, very interesting.
So it's very interesting that suddenly we have a plan for Bathurst, instructed by Darling, but then Mitchell seems to be snubbing his nose at Darling by saying, well, hang on, I'm going to put a square in. This is contrary to his instructions. It's also very well known that Mitchell and Darling were like cats and dogs.
Right.
They really did not agree on anything. They were constantly at loggerheads. Mm. They fought about all sorts of things. And Darling, had he been able, would have had Mitchell dismissed and would have been replaced by one of his sons-in-law, William Dumerick.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't happen for the simple reason because Mitchell's patron was George Murray, who was the minister for the colony and a Grand Master of the London Lodge. So if you look at the symbol of the 59th Regiment, it is this with a bugle, which is the which is a bit of a giveaway in terms of, you know, what that regiment was about. Now, it's probably worth someone finding out the history of the 59th Regiment in England and saying, look, let's pin this down. That'd be great. I haven't been able to myself. I just haven't had the time. But all of those links, I think, are fairly unmistakable. And what's also interesting is that Mitchell didn't start from a zero point. He actually used Macquarie's flagstaff.
Really?
And that flagstaff runs dead through that square. It's exactly 30 chains from that point to the midpoint of the road here. So all of these things, you know, suddenly fall into place. You suddenly realise that this is not an ordinary map of a town square.
This is a kind of a Masonic
has a Masonic background or predisposition, and he's telling us things. But, you know, no one's really spoken about it in my lifetime, at least, or to my knowledge.
Look, if it was in America, it would be spoken.
It probably would be on the lines of, you know, Washington, D.C., which is very much Paris and quite a number of cities around the world. And here we are out on the Bathurst Plains, you know. We've not only transported this sort of ideology or mythology or symbolism, but a Roman town. Because here we have... Well, he originally had the, you know, the jail here. The jail ends up, it did end up being on that side. But what transpired subsequently was that we ended up with the this being a marketplace, a spiritual place, and surrounded by government. So all the elements of society are represented. The spiritual, the mundane, as it were, and the authoritarian, the civic, realm. So it's really a Roman town. Here we are, you know, 2,000 plus years later, transporting a Roman idea with Masonic overlays into a place like Bathurst. So I was intrigued by these sort of things. And subsequently, what's happened is that other people have also picked up this alignment, because the when they rebuilt the cathedral, it still remains that the spire of the cathedral is exactly in the centre of the town square, and it lines up with this flagstaff, or what was the flagstaff at that point. Then we have the courthouse, and then we built the carillon right in that spot here. And all three, the spire of the church, the carillon and the courthouse spire, all line up in that, on that axis back to the flagstaff. What's more interesting is that the top of the spire, the top of the carillon and the top of the courthouse dome are all 100 feet above the ground.
That is
signature. I don't think these are accidents. I don't think this is happenstance. I think that they've been, for example, then we look at a cross section through the what is King's Parade here, and you would have seen that. There are statues and what have you placed there, and again they cross
War
that
and the Evans
Memorial. So they cross the axis in a different direction. But the people who did those were also Masons. Now, I'm not a Mason, but when I was asked to look at the competition entry for the bell tower, I knew about these alignments and I felt compelled to follow them because it made perfect sense in the overall context.
Artistically and it just made sense.
And at the same time I thought, well, I didn't want to compete with the three major edifices that are already there. They needed this new building had to be, I felt, subordinate to the predecessors. But it still respected the alignment all the way through and still had its own character, which was unique to the site, but was sympathetic to both the courthouse, the carillon, and the existing churches.
Well, I think you succeeded with that. It is
so all of those things needed to resolve, and that's where architects with some sort of background in these sort of things could be useful. So that's pretty much what's transpired.
That is just amazing.
Yeah, so even with the design of the bell tower, you'll see that that's a Celtic cross, and all those other symbols are there, the use of water.
The four orbs.
Yeah, all of those sort of things, again, are part of that symbolism, and which I think is what helps create civic places, mm-hmm. gives them meaning. And if we are to have sacred ground in Western civilization, these are the sort of elements that they invariably contain.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I'm interested in the actual building now.
Right.
It's got the four vaults.
Yeah.
Is there any particular reason you chose the vaults? To me, quite heavily studied as a non-Mason, right. Very similar to you, I think, and okay. a fascination.
Yeah, yeah.
I walk into there, it's an 18th degree room.
Right.
Like the four vaults talk about, you know.
I don't know much about that side of it. Mm. To me, there were other constraints about the bell tower that I had to meet.
Uh huh.
There are two bell towers in the square. Mm-hmm. There's this one, which is a peal of bells,
uh-huh.
which means that they're rung by
hand
by ropes, and they spin through 360 degrees backwards and forwards.
Oh, really?
The bell itself. Yeah. So when you've got eight bells up there. And they're all spinning.
That's a bit of force to deal
with. You've got a huge momentum force trying to make the building shift. And whereas the Carillon has 35 bells, but they're static, they are hit by a clapper from within. And they're hit by a pneumatic keyboard.
Uh-huh.
So it's a different structural problem. It's a dead load purely.
Mm.
Whereas this is a dead and alive load.
Wow.
So one of the problems that we had here was that the building needed to withstand these lateral horizontal forces of the bells trying to move and shift. And the worst thing you could build something like that out of is masonry, because masonry has no tensile strength whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And yet I was faced with the problem of trying to reconcile the brick buildings that I'm surrounded by.
Yeah, you don't want this steel edifice.
No, I didn't really want a steel structure there in a skeletal form.
Mm.
So what I've done is I've increased the cavity of the brickwork and used it as formwork and filled the void with reinforced concrete, which gave me the strength, and the permanent formwork is the brickwork.
Right, with Rio through the concrete.
Yeah, yeah. So I've tied the whole building together at each level,
mm-hmm.
and the arches actually help to reinforce. Because the forces that are generated by bells, four times the weight of the bells cubed multiplied by the height above ground. So these are enormous forces.
That's a big force.
We're talking about like a bus. Yeah, a bus, you know, shuddering backwards and forth trying to move the building. And that's why so many buildings that you see around Europe that have these bells are constantly under repair, because they're all masonry buildings,
mm-hmm.
and they don't have the properties. Little by little, they're reinforcing them with steel and concrete and mm-hmm. all the rest of it. But that was the problem here. The other problem we faced was that when we looked at the soil that we were in 13 and a half metres of highly reactive clay.
Highly reactive is just, it moves a lot.
Well, when it's dry, it shrinks.
Oh.
When it's wet, it swells and moves. So what would happen is the bell tower is moving. We'd end up with a leaning tower of Pisa. So we had to anchor this building down into the earth. And we drilled down till we found what we call refusal, which is bedrock. Yeah, and that went down 13 and a half metres into what we've discovered was an ancient riverbed.
Oh, wow. The Macquarie.
So probably the Macquarie, you know, umpteen million years back, was further up the hill.
Mm-hmm.
Then probably when Mount Panorama, which is an old volcanic rise,
mm-hmm.
would have lifted, and the river might have shifted mm-hmm. further down to where we are now, just mm-hmm. behind this building.
Mm-hmm.
So they're the kind of geological backgrounds, but we did actually find river stones and specks of gold and all that kind of thing. In fact, I remember joking to the bishop at the time that we could be down there for years, you know, but the trace elements of gold were there, but they weren't insignificant. Certainly not enough quantities to warrant pulling down the building, a gold mine. But anyway, that's what we had to do. We had to bring the building way down, and using the arches inside, simply meant that I could virtually reduce the distance between natural ground and where the bells were, and reduce those forces. So a lot of the, and the shape of the building itself, the kind of curved buttress, because when you curve something, it gives strength to it, like a corrugated sheet of iron. And not only that, curving them this way allowed me to make use of the acoustics in the bell tower itself, because then they disperse the sound,
right?
Rather than focal, create a focal point.
So it broadcasts more.
It disperses and blends the sound. Whereas had I done it the other way, you'd get like a focal point, because you'd have a convex lens, if sound, as it were. So all of these sort of problems interacted and resulted in this particular result. So that's how these things come about. It's not just about symbology. It's not just about a whim. It's how we bring all of those things
real
together.
Structural issues.
It's a multi-layered problem. And the trick, I think, for any architect, or the challenge, is always to find what's a simple and an elegant solution to that multitude of complexities. And this was my answer to those various problems.
And you managed to keep a beautiful symbol.
Well, I think so. Yeah, I think, as I say, it has a nice feel to it. It sits there as though it's always been there. And from that point of view, I'm very happy with it. As
I haven't actually heard. I've got a Bachelor of Music. I'm a composer under Peter Sculthorpe, and that's my background. How is the acoustic work?
Extremely well. We've had a number of people. I'm a musician as well. So that's why I was cognizant of the acoustic property properties of the building required anyway. But it I only know this because we've had quite a few bell ringers. This is a group of people, strangely enough, that tour the world with a little logbook, and they sort of tick off all the bell towers and carillons around the world that they've played. So we've had people from England and America and New Zealand and various places. In fact, the bell captain of Christchurch Cathedral was in Bathurst at the time that his own cathedral was being destroyed.
We'll just talking about that.
By the earthquake there, only what, last year was it?
Two years ago.
So he was very, very upset about that, as naturally. I didn't actually get to speak to him, but I was aware of the fact that he was here round about that time. But he and many, many others have said, you know, that this is one of the best sounding bell towers they've been to, which is a wonderful thing.
Great.
So I'm fairly happy that all of those parameters, you know, had been achieved.
And resolved, like you said.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's how I see it. You know, I kind of work the way nature does, and by that I simply mean things like even when you see a volcano, no matter how spectacular it is, it's still the minimum amount of energy required to create equilibrium. And that's how I look at architecture. What's the minimum that I need to do to create equilibrium? And this is an example of that philosophy, if you like.
And keeping in mind of all of that
stuff. And still being somehow embedded, as it were, in this deeper layer of the town. So all of those things became important and to the way I thought about resolving these problems.
And how did the bishop, did he appreciate?
Yeah, he
that?
Understood that. Yeah, I mean, how much credence or importance he placed on the kind of Masonic underpinnings, I don't really know, but I know he's extremely delighted with the tower and the result and the fact that it has meaning to the town and all the rest of it. So, look, it was a very wonderful client and
a great job.
It was one of those dream jobs. It's there's only. I think ours was the only bell tower under construction in the Southern Hemisphere at the time. So these are rare buildings.
Well, they are.
They're extremely rare. They're just, you know, people just don't build bell towers these days.
That's probably the one in Canberra on
the
Kings
Lake.
Island there.
That's a carillon. That's a carillon.
Right.
As distinct from a bell, peal of bells. Right. There are two things we need to keep separate. What's interesting about that is that there are only three or four places in the entire world where you have a peal of bells and a carillon side by side.
I wouldn't have thought so. It's, you know, Bathurst is very lucky.
Extremely
and both gridded
rare,
out.
Extremely rare, because Washington is a place where it has a carillon and a peal of bells, and there are a few others that I can't recall, but there are only a handful of them. And Bathurst does have a carillon, but it's not actually completed. Now, In 1933, we built the Bathurst built the Carillon.
First World War Memorial.
It was the memorial to the First World War. What's interesting about that is that it had intended to be a full blown carillon, and by that I mean a carillon is played by an instrument called a clavier, mm-hmm. which is a very large keyboard that you, instead of playing the black and white keys with your fingers as you do a piano, you actually hit each of these with a gloved hand and you slide up and down an 8-foot seat building away. And the beauty of that is that and you'll appreciate this as a musician, is that when you hit the note softly, you get a completely different set of harmonics than when you hit it really loud. Mm-hmm. So it opens up a whole different range of... Exactly right. So what it does, it creates music. Mm-hmm. At the moment, what we have is not an instrument that creates music. It makes musical sounds, but they are dead even, because each time you hit a bell, it's with the same intensity. So there's no piano and there's no forte. Mm-hmm. And as a result, you'd have no musical expression. It's actually what I've described as probably the world's most extravagant chime. Now, the council are at the moment looking at trying to complete the carillon by bringing in a clavier. So they're going to try and resurrect that. And and when that happens, Bathurst will be one of the few places in the world that has the carillon and a peal of bells side by side.
As so a composer, that'll bring in, that could be fun.
Well, it opens up all sorts of possibilities. But also, I mean, to those groups of people who do tour the world with their logbooks and playing bells, they'll have a better reason to come to Bathurst because they'll have the two instruments to play. At the moment, they're not interested in going up to the carillon, mm-hmm. because it's just a little dinky keyboard, and who cares, mm-hmm. It's not a proper instrument.
Right, wow.
So these are the other sort of background things.
And there's movement to do that, the council.
Oh, yes, indeed. Yeah, one of the things that Bathurst is looking at in 2015, Bathurst will be 200 years old. It is hoped, among the other things that we're trying to achieve, that the carillon will actually be completed for that year, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. which would be absolutely wonderful. Mm-hmm. So I actually did a report, or like a conservation management plan for the carillon, which showed its defects in terms of not being a proper carillon and why that happened and so on. So it's part of that ongoing...
Money is why.
Well, yes. I mean, originally there was a clavier as part of the contract, but then it was deleted. And I suspect that the reason for that was not so much monetary as the fact that we didn't have anyone who could play it. So although on opening day, you can imagine, we could have invited someone from Sydney, from the Sydney University Carillon, to come and play. But when what happens on Monday? we had a town full of piano players and organists. So the sensible thing, I think, at the time would have been, let's forget about the clavier, let's just put in a pneumatic keyboard, then anyone in town can play it. But in doing that, it was a practical and pragmatic decision, but at the same time it stopped the carillon from ever being one at that time. So although Bathurst has a reputation of being the carillon city, the truth is that we are not a carillon. So, well, yeah, it's ironical in a way, but there are now a number of people that are very keen to try and complete the picture and get the whole thing up and running.
And back to your building.
Yeah, sure.
One structure we've been studying is a symbol that is everywhere, which is four discs around a central disc. Now, is there any reason you chose that structure particularly?
Well, again, it had to do with trying to stabilise the building in clay soils. But I also like the symbolism that this was originally going to be, these were fountains originally. They've since been filled in with garden beds. Yes. Someone didn't like the maintenance on the fountains, which is a bit sad, because I felt that the flow of water was part of that symbolism, but it also was a way of reflecting the sound of the bells back out. Mm-hmm. So it was a very subtle inclusion, but it's also a place where people could sit and all the rest of it. So,
and the eternal flame, the water.
Well, all of those. Well, all of those things came together. The fire, the earth, the water, and sound. All those things were part of the elements, in a sense. And to me, it was an important part of the design, but sadly, it's now been converted into a weedy garden bed. So that's life, you know.
So we've been deeply studying some of the rituals involved in masonry.
Right, okay.
And how that each one of those orbs represents one of the elements.
Okay.
And that the magician or magus or stays in that central position.
Right.
Sort of invokes the elements, a common theme that we've...
That's more by accident here than intent. Although I do feel strongly about the use of water around or near buildings. I think water is kind of one of those life principles, you know, and attracts bird life and all sorts of other things. And it was just a lovely quality to the building. But, you know, I recognise also that the church have limits on their funds and maintenance is an issue, et cetera, et cetera. But anyway, that's how it all panned out. But I'm not... I don't know a lot about the Masons. I mean, I know that... I think Kathleen's out there, yeah. I mean, I have read one or two books about Masons and things, but I haven't sort of studied them as a thing in itself. You know, it's been peripheral too. But I noticed that, you know... when you go through history and you look at various things and you think, oh, this is an interesting person, then lo and behold, you discover that he or she is a Mason, mostly he. Well, exclusively he, I think. I don't think they have women in Masons.
Yes, co-masonry and, Order of the Eastern Star, which I believe is a temple in Bathurst, isn't it?
Well, I think there may well be. I know that Masons have been here a long time. But, yeah, I hadn't really studied Masons or Freemasons as such, but I was
sacred geometry. It's led you into it.
Well, yeah, I came from it from a different direction altogether. It was just by, you know, being puzzled about the configuration of buildings and why they had these strange properties or strange alignments and what have you. And then I started reading and became more and more intrigued with ley lines, which you brought up earlier. And the fact that a lot of, for instance, the Gothic cathedrals are all over springs and wells and streams, as is this one. Known or unknown.
Known or unknown.
Yeah.
This is sort of part of my thesis that, look, it's impossible for everyone. There's something working through all of us.
Well, one of the things that I remember coming across was that if you look at the conflict between, say, Indigenous peoples and the mining people, whether it's uranium or coal or iron ore or gold or whatever it may be, quite often you'll notice that they occur on what the Indigenous people call sacred ground. Mm-hmm. Now, it raised the question in my mind, what's the correlation between a concentration of a particular ore, whether it's uranium or gold or water or whatever, and people's response, like water diviners have a response to locations of water.
And there's a whole movement of divining for divining minerals as well.
Yeah. So it occurs to me that these people that regard sacred sites as sacred are responding to the natural elements that are concentrated there, again, whether it's oil or some other deposit, but the fact that it's in concentration is telling them physically something is special about this place, so they regard it as sacred. But it happens to be the location of an iron ore deposit or something else. I don't think that's an accident, because it happens too often. So again, I think that... Ancient civilizations saw these in sacred terms, whereas we see them in different terms. The two just happen to overlap, but with strange results. But I don't want to disillusion Indigenous people and their because these things are sacred, and they may be sacred for all hosts of reasons. But one of them, I think, is underpinned by the fact that there are certain deposits.
There's an earth energy
by the fact that one particular element is concentrated there.
It's very interesting.
Yeah, so I made that observation many years ago, and I thought, oh, yeah.
But again, I haven't made that observation. I'm very interested in observation.
Well, it's something that, again, you know, someone with time on their hands could study and say, look, you know, let's systematically look at sacred sites and the conflict that they've had with mining leases or other things, and see where there is in fact a true correlation, or whether
it's a worldwide thing.
Well, that's what occurred to me was that throughout Canada, for example, and Alaska, there where there are all sorts of mineral wealth and a lot of native populations, that there was always this conflict of sacred ground and sacred sites and all the rest of it with the more mundane interests of modern man. But again, I don't think it's an accident. I think that there are relationships there that are just simply perceived in different ways. Mm. That's not to say that other things may not be there as well.
Many factors, like you say.
I think so. So, you know, there may, these sites may be sacred for reasons other than the mineral deposit, in other words. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So, again, I don't know and can't really comment on that. But, yeah. But that, in a nutshell, I hope that answers some of your questions. The interesting thing about the flagstaff that was placed there by Macquarie, it became the set-out point not just for the whole of Bathurst, because Mitchell used that as his set-out point for the whole town and created that axial plan, but also it became the set-out point for all the surveyors and explorers that subsequently came through Bathurst to map and discover the inland Australia. So it's really the set-out point for the rest of Australia, this very flagstaff. Now, it's most unfortunate that the flagstaff, after probably 60 years being there, withered away or whatever and fell over and was never quite replaced or noted as its location, and eventually became quite lost. In more recent times, the council found that as an ideal spot to put a toilet block and a sewer vent pipe, which marks more or less where that flagstaff once was. There are now moves afoot by the council, I understand, to rethink this area, because Bathurst is coming up to its 200th birthday, the bicentennial, in 2015, and on the 7th of May, which will be Proclamation Day, when Macquarie placed the flagstaff there in 1815, something hopefully better than a toilet block and a sewer vent pipe might
really
be there.
It's the first
construction or piece of structure outside of Sydney, the first inland piece of construction, European construction that is, outside Sydney really, so in 1815. It's the first thing they erected. That possibly the first thing might have been Macquarie's Bengal tent, but I mean, I'm talking about a permanent structure. This would have been the first permanent structure. The first thing they would have done is put up a flagpole, which would have been a ship's mast. I don't know what size it may have been, 10 metres tall, 30 foot mast, which they would have carried over with drays and what have you, over the mountains, and would have run up the Union Jack. So that would have been the first thing that would have seen in this area as a structure. Flagpole, Union Jack, and invariably the survey marker peg for the rest of Australia. So it has quite a colourful little history in itself.
Really?
But that is where Mitchell, as you can see, notes that quite deliberately.
Very deliberately.
Then we've done a check on this, and it's exactly 30 changed to the centre point of that, which, and these were 10-acre blocks. So all of these are in, imperial kind of units and fairly even numbers. You know, if you scale that, it's not 33.654 or something, it's exactly 30 change. And again, these are no accidents, I think that this is quite deliberate.
Mm-hmm.
So all of that kind of ties together with how the town grew. And I think it's sad in a way that when we see that this is no longer a flagstaff but a toilet and a sewer vent pipe, shows us that not knowing our history in detail has consequences. You know, the fact that we lost the town square is a consequence of not knowing our history.
Mm-hmm.
Losing this is the same consequence. And I think it's sad that we don't, we probably know more about American history and about European history than we do about the subtle underpinnings of our own history.
The subtle underpinnings, that's a very good way of describing it.
So I think these are important elements,
And in this, we're in the 200th anniversary of the crossing.
Correct,
this year,
that's
it's
correct.
A pertinent time for it to come out.
So, all of these things have a time and place, I guess, and Canberra is celebrating its 100th this year, 1913. And it was 1813 that they crossed the mountains originally, and within 2 years they'd built a road, quite a magnificent undertaking in itself, 6 months to hack their way through the mountains and then arrive here. So this is the terminus point for that road, the first road out of Sydney.
Cox's Road,
that's where it terminates.
It's just amazing.
So there we are.
knocks off probably about 120 decibels of that sound, so that the ringers down below have sufficient hearing capability that they can listen to the bells, hear what their bell is doing when they're ringing it, and they can also hear the instructions from the conductor. And so getting that balance was very, very difficult, because many towers were built with towers that are so high, the need to protect the bell ringer's ears wasn't there. But this is more custom built, and so there had to be some attempt at calculating what the dissipation of sound in this compartment was going to yield. Henry got it right. What we also find is, because we're very close to the cathedral, we get a back echo from that building, which comes just a fraction of a second after we hear it coming straight down. It's like a dog leg going up there. And we can only avoid that by keeping the windows in the tower on that side shut, which acts as a baffle. But the ringing chamber is still a little bit too loud, and we're thinking of ways of trying to quieten that down. And one suggestion has been given to us, that we should get hold of a carpet manufacturer, or carpet sales, a retail outlet, and with some old carpet, put it on the top of this.
Maybe a couple of layers.
Well, if we're lucky enough, it's a big area. And so getting carpet that will look reasonably safe in here, it won't cause tripping for people going up and down, we'll try that and see whether we can quench some of the sound that's coming down.
And maybe even some thick molten wool drapes might help too.
Yes, that's right. That's high density foam. Mm-hmm. And we put that on that wood to stop that being a source of noise leaking. But if we were able to drape the whole inside with that high density foam, the chances are it would be far more efficient.
Right.
Concrete's got sort of natural prevention of the sound, but even so, it resonates in the chamber and comes down through those holes there.
Of course.
And if we put in a stormwater pipe, which fitted outside that little black boss, the chances are that would eliminate some of the sound as well.
Yeah, physically I can see it.
And you might also like to look at the lamina, which is on the top of the trap door. Mm-hmm. You will see there's a little bit of foam, a little bit of rubber midway between two plywood sheets.
Yes, right.
That is high tech. That will absorb a great deal of sound.
Mm-hmm. Were you involved with the design process?
No, we weren't. Henry, I think, went down, spent several days in the Sydney Towers, and he spent a little time in Lithgow, the town just on the western side of the Blue Mountains, and looked at that tower there, where we had been training while this was under construction.
Right, right. And you're training for a competition now?
We're looking at a striking competition. There's a lot of bells in a lot of towers in the country areas of New South Wales, and generally speaking, they've all been established in the recent years, so there's no great depth of experience in any of the ringers that are working in those towers. And so,
as opposed to England.
Oh, in England, every town has got ringers who've been ringing since they were at school, so they're all pretty, pretty good. But it's different here, it's had a different history. And the competition we're working on now is to measure the number of errors we make in ringing what's known as 34 changes altogether. Because with 8 bells, it's possible, if your mathematics will tell you, it's 40,320 different sequences with 8 bells. And so what we're looking at is doing about 36 of those and doing them cleanly. So anyone listening will hear the changes of pitch, but they won't hear any break in the rhythm.
Rhythm will stay constant.
That's right. That's the idea. That's what we try to do. If the cooling process is not controlled and is totally uniform, stresses will build up in the tower, in the bell, and after continuous hammering, that will cause a crack. And we can't take the roof off every time a bell cracks. So we have to find a way of getting them down again so they can be sent away, either to be welded or to be melted down and recast. And those holes there are just large enough to take the largest of our bells. But what? So we have this upside down railway line.
It's very clever.
And we're very fortunate because we could have the benefit of much new technology in this type of a configuration, which is nice and circular and gives below a nice evenly spaced ringing circle. So the ringers are a nice comfortable distance from each other and they can each see what the other is doing.
And each bell is going full circle.
Full circle, yeah. What I will do, I'll silence one of these bells and go down and ring it for you. You'll hear a hum. There's no danger in it, but it's, some people don't like it. So if you put your fingers in your ears, it will certainly sort take the sting out of it.
And the ninth rope is another bell.
Well, that's a tolling bell that goes on the roof. The eight bells traditionally are used for calling to worship on a Sunday. But if during the week, and there's a service in the cathedral of different sizes every day of the week, and if the clergy feel inclined, they can toll that bell, because the ringing of it is controlled from the entrance to the cathedral, where you came in. So, but many of them don't want to do that. One or two have tried, and they've gone sick a few days later. But that's really for incidental ringing, and maybe for some special occasions, like someone who's died, and that bell will represent the last rites. You know. But if you'll please stay here, I will go and that bell there's a good one. I'll go and silence that, and you see there's nothing high tech about this muffling. It's just a motorcycle tire which is chopped across its cross section with a hole in the end, which is tight enough on the clapper to not to turn of its own volition. So I'll turn that and you'll see the action. The bell goes just over 360 degrees until it comes to that point of rest on each occasion.
It's not an actual rice, it's a
number.